Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nest, a Thriller by Terry Goodkind. Read by Elisabeth Rodgers.
Chapter 1. For the past 3 weeks, John Allen Bishop had been keeping the devil chained in the basement. What exactly the devil had been doing in Chicago, John didn't know, and the devil wasn't saying. What John did know was that over the past several days, the situation had been getting increasingly worrisome. At first, the threats yelled up from the basement had been the most vile things imaginable, things that John would have expected to hear from the devil. But in the last few days, something had changed. In those long, hushed moments as the sun went down and the world went still, John had found himself shuffling closer to the basement door, carefully leaning in, stretching his neck to put his ear close to the narrow crack in the door that led to the darkness down below. That was when he had first heard the whispers. Since the floor squeaked, the devil knew whenever John was in the kitchen, near the top of the stairs. When John put his ear close to the crack in the door, the devil always greeted him by name. Sometimes the devil chuckled softly to himself. The whispered promises never failed to make John's mouth go dry. But now, the menace in the basement had inexplicably fallen silent. The silence worried him more than the whispers had. He paced from the refrigerator to the sink and back, debating what to do. He didn't relish the thought of going down there again. The chain was strong enough, he was sure of that, and he knew how far it could reach. He knew to the inch. Still, he didn't want to go down there any sooner than he had to. As he paced, the fluorescent light hummed above a sink full of disorderly stacks of dirty dishes, a clump of crusted forks waiting to be washed, stuck up from a cracked green plastic tumbler. Ordinarily, John prided himself on being tidy, but with the dire turn of events, he certainly didn't think he could be blamed for ignoring the dishes. The dishes would just have to wait. The devil was more important. John turned away from the mess in the sink and paced back toward the refrigerator, following the same track he'd been walking for the past hour as regret kept building, bringing on the familiar weight of indecision. He didn't know how he had ever gotten such a crazy idea in the first place. He hadn't thought it through. He realized that now. He should have thought it through. People always told him to think things through. But what else could he have done? It had been so unexpected. He had to do something. The devil knew things. Too many things. It had seemed simple at first. Chain up the devil. The world would be safe. Kate would be safe. It was turning out to be not so simple. John told himself that he should go down and bash in the devil's head. He knew he should. There were tools in the basement, beyond the reach of the chain, of course. There was a sledgehammer that could do the ghastly job. But John didn't have that much courage. He should have done it in the beginning, when the devil had been unconscious, but he hadn't had the courage then either. Even as he tried to summon the courage to do what needed doing, he knew that his chance had passed. John wondered if he should call Detective Janek. From time to time, she would come to see him, to show him the pictures. She was nice. He liked helping her. He glanced over at the phone on the wall in the hallway. Detective Janek's card was sitting on the top of the phone, leaning against the wall. She had left it there one day when she'd told him that he could call her any time, day or night. He wondered if maybe he should do that now. John didn't like to use the phone, though. He didn't like to call people. He got confused on the phone. He feared that this was different from the time she'd come to see him. He feared that this time she might not believe him. He might even get into trouble. Fear and doubt welled up. What if he lost his job? His sister had helped him get his job. She'd told him that he could do it, told him to do his best. It was the first job that he'd ever had. He liked his job of fitting the colorful plastic pieces together, but mostly he liked that it made him independent. Having his job meant he could pay the bills and take care of himself. Kate helped him when he got confused, but he could do most things on his own. She said that she was proud of him, of how well he was doing. He liked being on his own. He didn't want to lose his job. He didn't want Kate to be disappointed in him. John didn't ever tell his sister about Detective Janek. He didn't want her to be afraid. It was the only way he could protect her. He knew that it was wrong to chain people in the basement, of course, but this wasn't a regular person. This was the devil. Still, he feared that even Detective Janek might not believe him. He suddenly wondered if he might even be put in jail. John wiped his sweaty palms on his pant legs. He swallowed in terror at what might happen to him if he was arrested. The very thought of going to jail and having to look into the eyes of all those men nearly made his knees give out. His attention was snatched by his own shadow falling across the refrigerator. He drew his collar tight at his throat and told himself that he had things under control. He just had to keep them that way, that was all. It was getting late, and he knew that he needed to get down there. He didn't like taking food down to the basement, but John just didn't have it in him to kill, either by a quick blow or by slow starvation. He couldn't stand it when people hurt, even if the hurt was hunger. Distantly, through the tumbling fragments of thoughts pulling him this way and that, it seemed that there was something not right about the refrigerator. Something different. In the dim light, he surveyed the newspaper clippings that he had carefully cut out and taped to the door. They were all still there. John hated the stark look of the white refrigerator, so he frequently taped items that interested him on the blank door after he had carefully folded over the pointed corners. He didn't like sharp points. He changed the clippings often, whenever something new caught his eye. It didn't have to be anything especially meaningful. Pictures of animals, headlines about holidays, or sometimes even just a single word that was pleasing. Anything to cover the nakedness of the refrigerator. There were photos as well, their corners also carefully bent over, stuck on the refrigerator door with word magnets. He smiled back at his sister smiling out at him from a sunny beach, from behind the wheel of her first car, from the couch in his living room. He scanned the newspaper headlines about parades and holidays and sunny forecasts, looking for something new, something that might have changed, some word, some sign. Then he spotted what wasn't right. There were dozens of little magnets attached to the door. They'd been a birthday gift from his sister. Each magnet was a white word on a black background. He liked to arrange the words so that they rhymed or so that they said something cheerful. The words stuck to the white metal door always seemed welcoming, offering a friendly greeting when he came home and went to get himself something to eat, or, like now, when he went to get the devil something to eat. The last message he'd made from arranging the magnets was still there. A castle keeps you safe. He'd made the saying with the magnets some time ago, after he had heard that a man's home was his castle. Except for going to work in the store, John didn't like going out. He liked to be inside. Safe. Home was safe. Home was his castle. Chaining up the devil was the most daring thing John had ever done in his whole life. But now, the little magnets that he had so carefully arranged into a castle keeps you safe were no longer in a line by themselves the way they had been. All the spare words that had been pushed off to the right side were now arranged into a circle, leaving a cleared round white patch near the refrigerator's door handle. A castle keeps you safe sat in the middle of that circle. But now, there were new words arranged in a neat line below, as if in answer. The new words said, "Not anymore." Chapter 2. John leaned closer and peered at the new words. Not anymore. He hadn't put those words there. He glanced over at the basement door. It was a thick, six-panel pine door. Here and there, faded blue peeked through the peeling, cream-colored paint. John remembered happy times playing on the floor in the kitchen when that door had been all blue. The door was open a little, at the top corner, because it was warped and wouldn't close properly. The door had a lock, but John didn't have a key for it. It was one of those old-fashioned keyholes, like he'd seen in cartoons and the movies. When he had been little, John used to peer through the keyhole and pretend that he was a spy watching for danger. Now, he knew what sort of danger waited on the other side of that door. Through the slit of the partially open door, he could see inky blackness. The devil down below in that darkness was silent. Not even a whisper came up from the basement. John wondered if that was a good thing or not. He stood still as a stone, leaning in, listening. John reconsidered calling the police. He glanced again at the card that Detective Janek had set on the top of his wall phone after she had carefully folded over the corners so the points wouldn't scare him. She had always been nice to him, always believed him, but he wondered if she would believe him this time. If Detective Janek went down in the basement and saw him, if she just looked into his eyes, wouldn't she know? John had looked into the devil's eyes. John knew. As he stood motionless, watching the sliver of blackness from below, he realized that his castle wasn't as safe as he had thought it was. That was what the words on the refrigerator meant. This place wasn't safe anymore. Not since the devil had come into it. John stole another glance at the aqua-colored phone hanging on the floral-papered wall at the side of the stairwell leading upstairs, just around the corner from the basement door. Maybe he should call Detective Janek. The police would want to know that the devil was in Chicago. Or maybe he should call his sister. The devil knew her name. She ought to know that the devil knew her name. He should call Kate and tell her. He wanted her to be safe. If he called her, she might know what to do. The police might not listen to him, might not believe him, but Kate would believe him this time. She had to. All at once, the solution seemed clear. He would call his sister and tell her everything, tell her what had happened, tell her that the devil knew her name too, just like he'd known John's name. She would know what to do. Springing into action, John hastily pulled all the pictures of his sister off the refrigerator door. The magnets holding them rained down, clattering on the floor. Rather than slow to pick up the magnets, he started stuffing the photos in the front pocket of his work pants. He was worried that the devil might look at Kate's pictures. He didn't think it would be a good idea to let the devil get a look at his sister. John didn't want evil looking at her. Once the photos were all tucked safely into his pocket, he hurried into the hallway to call her. Just as he reached for the receiver, the phone rang. His heart pounding out of control, John snatched up the handpiece and put it to his ear, listening. He feared that it might be the devil calling him from the basement. "Hi, Johnny. It's me." John felt a wave of giddy relief wash through him at hearing his sister's familiar, cheerful voice. He clutched the tangled cord with his other hand as he sagged against the wall. "Hi, Kate," he said in an expectant pant. He glanced toward the slit of darkness under the basement floor. "I'm back from my trip a day early, and the driver is about to drop me at home." "Uh-huh. What's the matter? You sound winded. Did you just run up the front steps?" John needed to tell her about the devil. Kate would know what to do. She was smart. His sister always knew what to do. She always helped him. He missed her. Right at that moment, he missed her more than anything in the world. He cupped the phone close with both hands so that the devil couldn't hear.
No.
Hey. Listen, she said, not pressing. She was the only one who didn't get impatient and press him. I got a call from a lawyer. John blinked.
A lawyer?
Yeah, remember Mom's half-brother who lived out west? Everett? Remember him? John wasn't sure he did. With all the things racing through his mind as he stared at the basement door, it was hard to think. She breathed a lighthearted laugh. Me neither, really. We went there once, to his trailer out in that little town in the desert. He wasn't the friendliest guy. You were little at the time. I wouldn't expect you to remember him. I hardly remember him myself. Anyway, I'm afraid he died. John turned his eyes from the dark slit.
Died?
Yeah. The lawyer said it was about 3 weeks ago.
3 weeks?
Yeah, almost 4 weeks ago. John wiped a tear from his cheek as he listened to her breathing for a moment before she went on. I know how it bothers you when people die, John. But he was really old. Don't be too sad. He never left that place of his, and I bet it was because he loved it just like you love your house. I bet he had a good life there, a good long life.
What did he die of?
There was a long moment of silence before she said, He was old, John. She didn't want to tell him. He knew that sometimes Kate didn't want to tell him things, so she would say something simple. Anyway, the lawyer said that we're the only relatives and Everett left his place to us. He doesn't think the estate is worth a great deal, but it belongs to you and me now. I'm going to have to go out there and handle it. I guess I'll have to see about selling the place or something. John glanced back at the basement door. He needed to tell her before anything else happened. He swallowed as he gathered his courage, determined to tell her the whole story from the beginning.
I went to the cemetery, he blurted out.
You did? She paused, seeming surprised. Alone? John nodded, and all of a sudden started talking faster, trying to get it out all at once.
I went to the store and bought flowers and then put them on Mom and Pop's grave by the headstones, like you showed me, in the vase, the way the cemetery people like it done. I put your name on the card, too.
That's so sweet. Her voice had turned soft. Thanks. I bet Mom and Pop liked the flowers. She cleared her throat. When did you go to the cemetery? He'd never gone there alone before. John wiped the back of his hand across his nose, trying not to cry.
3 weeks ago.
He felt another tear run down his cheek. He had to tell her. She would know what to do.
I was there, and someone was watching me. And then when I got home, the basement light snapped on.
John froze. He stood, motionless, staring wide-eyed at the slit of light stabbing up from below the door. John, it was probably just someone else putting flowers on a grave, his sister said in his ear. He couldn't make himself talk. In his head, he was screaming, Tell her! Hurry! Tell her! But he couldn't make the words come out. His voice wouldn't work. He was afraid to make a sound. And then something else came up from beyond the doorway. A low voice, speaking his name. His whole name. The way people used to do when he was little and he'd gotten himself into trouble.
John Allen Bishop.
He watched the shafts of light from below shifting, lighter, darker, and lighter again. John? Kate asked. Is there someone there in the house with you? He desperately wanted Kate's help. But what if the devil could get to her through the phone? He didn't want danger coming near his sister. The hiss of a voice from below called his name again, but just the first part. Then again, coming closer, moving up the stairs. The door creaked as it started to open. John? What's that sound? Do you have company? John?
Run, Kate! He screamed into the receiver. Run!
John slammed the phone back on the hook so that the devil couldn't get to her through the phone lines. He raced for the front door as fast as his crooked legs would carry him. He nearly made it. A great weight slammed into him from behind, smashing him face first into the door. He rebounded only to have a powerful hand grab his shirt and spin him around. The impact had dazed him. His nose felt like it had been hit with a baseball bat. He felt warm blood running down his face, dripping off his chin. The thought of so much blood gushing out of his nose horrified him. John looked up and went stiff with terror. The devil had his pitchfork. His eyes seemed lit from within by pure evil. They were eyes that sought only to see suffering. His face twisting in rage, the devil roared as he drove his pitchfork down at the floor. The tines of the pitchfork punctured both of John's shoes, severed the bones in his feet, pierced the heavy soles, and stuck solidly in the floorboards. Even if John had tried to move, he wouldn't have been able to. He was pinned to the floor. As he stood in stunned terror, the devil slid a hand down into John's pants pocket. He pulled out the photos of Kate. As John trembled, unable to think, the pain keeping him from trying to move, the devil slowly looked at the pictures, one by one, his wicked smile growing wider and wider. John didn't want the devil to look at Kate. He snatched for the photos. The devil caught John's hand and twisted his fingers back until they snapped with sickening pops like twigs breaking. As John screamed in shock and pain, holding his twisted and broken fingers with his good hand, the devil slipped the photos of Kate into his own pocket.
You've caused me quite a bit of trouble, Johnny boy.
Leave us alone,
John wept.
Please.
Towering over him, the devil peered deeply into John's eyes.
Do you remember my promise, John?
The shocking pain of his feet impaled by the tines was just starting to register through paralyzing panic and the horrific agony of his ruined fingers. He remembered the promises. He remembered them all too well. John's helpless sobs grew louder.
What do you see with those eyes of yours?
The devil asked as he loomed closer yet, as if trying to see some secret hidden in John's eyes.
What do you see, Johnny boy?
He whispered from only an inch away. John shook uncontrollably.
Nothing.
I think you see way too much.
A big hand grabbed John's hair at the back of his head.
I'm going to fix that.
And then the devil leaned close, his mouth beside John's ear, and he again whispered his promise.
I'm going to bring you everlasting darkness.
John shrieked in fright and pain as something terribly long and sickeningly sharp slammed twice up into the core of his body. He couldn't draw the full breath he so desperately needed. The devil's teeth looked huge as his jaws opened wide, coming for what he wanted. The teeth raked John's face, peeling away his eyelids.
In the scheme of things,
the devil said, as he forced a thumb deep into the side of one of John's eye sockets.
This doesn't really matter. After all, the universe, too, is blind.
The distant words made no sense to John as he struggled and screamed in the agony that was only just beginning. He felt twisting pain and darkness pressing into his eyes. He hoped that Kate would run. Run fast. Run far. Get away. Chapter 3. Kate looked up when Detective Sanders called her name. She was in a daze. None of it felt real. He leaned an arm on the roof of the car just above the open back door where she sat, sideways, despairing because there was nothing she could do. He'd been the one who had met her and taken her aside when she had arrived at John's house. He was older and a bit overweight, and more comforting than his austere, pockmarked face had at first suggested.
"Miss Bishop," he said in a sympathetic but formal tone, "do you feel up to answering a few questions?"
Kate nodded. "But I'm afraid I don't know anything that could help you find out who could have done this." A woman detective in a dark suit stood nearby, within earshot, as she scanned the scene lit by all the headlights of police cars. She had only just arrived and hadn't said anything after coming out of the house. She looked to be a few years older than Kate, maybe in her middle 30s. Her posture, her shoulders, the open collar of her stark white shirt, and the cut of her clothes suggested that she took care of herself. Her short brown hair turned inward just below her strong jawline. Her dark eyes scrutinized Kate so closely, so deliberately, that it was beginning to make her feel self-conscious. Detective Gibson, also in a white shirt, a tie, and a gray jacket similar to the one that Detective Sanders wore, returned from the house to whisper to the woman detective. Like Detective Sanders's, his hair was cut so short it was the next closest thing to being shaved bald. Thick skin bunched up in creases at the back of his bull neck. Detective Sanders sucked something from between his two front teeth and held up a finger toward Kate to excuse himself for a moment as he stepped away to speak with the others. All three wore police badges on their belts. Under their jackets, at their sides, Kate saw that they all carried Glock handguns. The detectives all seemed professional in a way that Kate found reassuring, if there could be such a thing in such a situation. A pair of patrolmen in dark uniforms stood at ease on the porch, flanking the front door, seeing to it that no one without authorization went in. All the activity was quieting down somewhat, now that her brother's body had finally been removed from the house to a coroner's van. She wondered what she would need to do to recover her brother for burial. She supposed she should call the funeral home she had used for her parents. They would likely know what to do. People carrying cases of equipment came and went. All of the activities and procedures were a confusing mystery to Kate, although they were obviously looking for evidence to try to find the killer. From time to time, she'd seen flashes, as everything in the house, it seemed, had been photographed. But even if she didn't know much about their specific jobs, she recognized that they were well orchestrated and methodical as they went about their tasks. No one wandered around in confusion. Everyone but Kate knew what to do. No one hurried, either. She supposed that there wasn't any point in rushing. There was no one to rescue, no fleeing suspect to chase down and arrest. Besides, this was their daily job. It was just another day at work to them. Kate knew that for her, it would always stand out as one in a handful of the worst days in her life. When she'd first arrived, she had wanted to go into the house and see her brother. The detectives wouldn't let her. They told her that they needed to do their work first. Detective Sanders told her, in a confidential tone, that it would be better if she didn't see her brother that way, in the house where it had happened. He told her that she would not want that to be her memory of her brother. As much as she'd thought that she wanted to see for herself, his candor, as he had looked into her eyes, had given her pause and made her realize that he was probably right. With all the people going in and out, the detectives huddled in hushed discussions, and the technicians carrying equipment, it was hard to imagine the horrific scene in the house. In a way, the unknown only made it worse. So far, the only thing she knew for sure was that her brother was dead. Right from the beginning, they'd said that it was murder. The way they said it made it clear that there was no doubt at all about that part of it. Kate couldn't stop her imagination from racing off in every direction. But most of all, she couldn't imagine why anyone would harm her brother. On the sidewalk to either side of the house, beyond the police tape, the crowds of onlookers had thinned as the night had worn on. When she'd first arrived, a lot of people had been milling around outside the house, watching, gossiping, and worrying about what kind of maniac might be loose in the neighborhood. Once, an odd, uneasy feeling had made her look up. A tall man with disheveled hair, his hands stuffed into the pockets of a light jacket, was just turning away. Even though she didn't catch sight of his face, she could tell by the way he slipped back through the crowd that he had been standing there, watching her. It gave her a chill to have strangers staring at her like that. It made her feel naked and vulnerable. Other people looked away from her when she glanced in their direction. They, too, had been staring at her. Detectives or uniformed officers had been close by Kate the whole time, saying little, explaining some of the process when she asked questions about suspects, about her brother's body, about what they were doing with it, and what she would need to do. Reporters, cameramen, and news crews holding up lights had talked to a higher-ranking police officer who basically told them nothing except that the victim was named John Allen Bishop, and he had apparently been murdered in his home by an unknown assailant. When they asked about how it had happened, he said the details were being withheld and gave a number for tips. Impeccably dressed on-air female reporters talked into cameras for the 11 o'clock news, describing it as a grisly scene. Thankfully, the police had kept Kate sheltered from the news people, not letting them know she was the victim's sister. Having a reporter with fresh lipstick shove a microphone in her face and ask how she felt when she had learned that her brother had been murdered was about the last thing in the world Kate wanted to have to deal with. "He didn't suffer, did he?" Kate asked up to Detective Sanders when he finally returned. She wondered if she'd already asked the question, but if she had, she didn't remember his answer. "Did John suffer? Can you at least tell me that?" Detective Sanders stopped leafing through his notes as he looked down from beside the open car door.
"I can't say for sure, Miss Bishop, but I don't believe so. We believe it to have been over quickly."
Kate pulled a crumpled tissue from the pocket of her jeans and worked it in her fingers. He returned to methodically flipping back through his notes.
"Miss Bishop, you said that when you were on the phone with him, your brother suddenly yelled at you to run and then hung up."
Kate nodded. "That's right. I called 911 right away."
"Do you have any idea why he would say such a thing? Why would he say to run? You weren't close to his house."
Kate wiped her nose with the tissue before answering. With John's mental handicap, he wasn't able to understand things the way a normal adult could. Being halfway across the city or even halfway across the country wouldn't have meant anything to him if he was afraid. He viewed the world simplistically, as if everything was immediately around him. He didn't grasp concepts like distance very well. Detective Sanders gestured with his pen.
"So when he said for you to run, you feel that he might have simply meant that there was someone there, in the house. And so, in his way of thinking, that person represented a danger to you as well as to him."
"Probably." Kate brushed her black bangs to the side as she glanced up. "He always worried about me."
"And with his mental disability, he was still able to hold down a job?"
Detective Gibson asked as he stepped up beside Detective Sanders. "Yes." Kate looked up into the man's unexpressive face. He worked at the Clarkson Center for Developmental Disability. She gestured over her shoulder. On Hamilton Street. They provide work that people like John can do. It helps them be self-sufficient. The doctors had recommended that he be allowed to lead as normal a life as possible.
So you feel he was competent to live alone?
Detective Gibson asked. Despite his formidable looks, he had an agreeable voice. She could tell that he was deliberately trying not to make it sound like an accusation of negligence on her part. Yes. Fortunately, he wasn't as profoundly mentally handicapped as some. He was able to take care of himself pretty well. The doctors said that it would be better for him if he did, if he felt responsible for his own life. Having a sense of purpose and control really did help him be happier. He took the bus to work and back. He could walk to the store. The people there all know him. He could mostly take care of himself, and he liked doing it. He felt comfortable in the limited places he went. He wasn't left to fend for himself as much as it might seem. Unless I was out of town for my job, I'd come over often to check on him. I drove him places like to the doctor or to the dentist or to go out for a meal. Sometimes I'd take him with me when I shopped for clothes. He liked that. As long as I was with him when he was in a strange environment, he felt safe. I helped him take care of his bills, made sure that he ate properly, made sure he did his chores, things like that. He was slow, but he could do simple things for himself. It was hard on me, emotionally, not to be there all the time, but I think it was right for him to be able to live his own life.
When was the last time you were here?
Detective Sanders asked, without looking up, as he wrote in his notebook.
The last time you actually saw him.
Kate rubbed her fingertips back and forth across her brow. A little over 3 weeks ago. I've never been gone for that long before, but I had to be in Dallas for my job. I'm an auditor at KDEX Systems. There were irregularities at our office in Dallas, and I had to go down there to look into it. I called John just about every night, though.
So the reason for your call to him earlier tonight was to let him know that you were back in town?
Yes. Kate looked up at the man's waiting face. Besides checking on him, I had to tell him that a relative, my mother's half-brother, had died. I just found out about it earlier today.
I'm sorry to hear about that, ma'am,
Detective Gibson said.
When did he pass away?
He died a little over 3 weeks ago, the 12th of last month, out in Nevada. He was murdered. Detective Sanders looked at her over the top of his notebook.
Murdered?
Chapter 4. Detective Gibson, a few creases appearing on his brow, asked the same thing.
This uncle of yours was murdered?
Yes.
How was he killed?
Detective Sanders asked. Kate lifted a hand in a weak gesture. I'm not sure of the circumstances. An Esmeralda County sheriff out in Nevada called to tell me that Everett had been killed in the course of a robbery. It didn't make a lot of sense. Everett didn't have much worth stealing, at least not from what I knew of him.
Did they say how he was murdered? Any specifics?
Kate shook her head. No. Just that he'd been killed in the course of a robbery. I assumed that he'd been shot, but now that you ask, I guess I don't know that for a fact. I only met Everett once when I was a girl and don't really know much about him. The sheriff gave me the number of Everett's lawyer and suggested I call him. When I did, the lawyer told me that John and I had been named in Everett's will because we were the only next of kin. I thought Everett would have left his things to a friend or someone he knew out there, but he didn't. Whatever he has, he left it to us. The lawyer said that Everett had long ago made arrangements for his burial, one of those payment plans, so he had already been laid to rest as per his wishes. The lawyer said that John and I now owned the trailer Everett lived in, his pickup, and his personal effects. I'm supposed to go out there and see to them as soon as it's convenient. But now, she gestured helplessly toward the house, She felt stupid for not having asked such a basic question as how a relative had been murdered. It wasn't like her not to ask questions. In fact, her job was to investigate, ask questions, get to the bottom of things. But it had been such an unexpected call and such unexpected news that she hadn't thought to ask how he had been killed. That, and the sheriff had been rather terse in a way that didn't invite questions. She thought that with a murder on his hands, he must have been busy. With a thumb, Kate smoothed down creases on the leg of her jeans as she watched another man wearing latex gloves carry a black plastic bag out of the house, then slide open the door of a white police van and put the bag inside. Kate didn't really even know Everett. He was a hermit of sorts and virtually a stranger to her. Needing to handle his estate had seemed like it was going to be a nuisance she really didn't need. After the call, it had occurred to her that maybe she could tell the lawyer to simply donate everything to a charity. Detective Gibson started back toward his car.
"I'll go check it out," he said over his shoulder to Detective Sanders.
As she watched him walking away, Kate noticed the female detective still standing close, listening, watching her.
"Did your brother have any disagreements with anyone at his job?" Detective Sanders asked.
Kate glanced up at the frown on his pockmarked face. "I don't think so. John always told me about what was happening in his life. He never mentioned anything like that. He was upset a while back because some kids called him names when he was walking home from the bus. Once he told me about it, he seemed to feel better. I think he'd forgotten all about it by the next day. He liked his job. He always said that the people there were nice. John depended on me to protect him when he was afraid. I think he would have told me if he was having any kind of trouble at work." With the notepad in one hand and his pen in the other, Detective Sanders hiked up his pants as he eyed a group of men leaving the house with boxes and metal cases. Each person took off blue paper booties and put them in a sack on the porch.
"Miss Bishop, would you be willing to go in with us? They haven't cleaned up anything, except for removing your brother, but it would be a big help if maybe you could explain a few things for us. But if you don't feel comfortable..."
"Is there still blood? Has the blood been cleaned up?" The woman detective, surveying the darkness and the spectators, turned away and stepped closer to Kate to explain.
"I'm afraid that we have to leave everything as is until the investigation is complete. We can recommend a couple of companies that are licensed and bonded to clean up crime scenes. When the investigation is finished, in a few days they can come in and take care of everything for you. They have the proper experience. It's better to let them handle it. We'd just like you to take a quick look around, now, if you feel up to it."
The woman put out a hand to steady Kate when she stood, but Kate didn't need the hand.
"I'm Detective Janek, by the way," the woman said as she shook Kate's hand. "I'll go with you, if you're willing to go inside and maybe help us answer a few questions."
If she was willing? For hours, Kate had been asking them to let her go in. Instead of reminding them of that fact, she forced a brief smile. "I'm fine. Really. It's just such a shock. I can't believe that someone would want to hurt John. He was like a kid, you know, innocently happy most of the time. I just can't believe that anyone would want to hurt him." She thought again about her mother's half-brother, Everett. "Was John killed in a robbery? Was someone robbing the house and they killed John?" The detective shared a look. Detective Janek leaned in a little.
"Listen, Miss Bishop."
"Please, call me Kate." Miss Bishop was what people working for Kadex Systems always called her when she showed up unexpectedly from the home office. Detective Janek smiled. Kate thought it looked genuine.
"Kate, We need to tell you about a few things before you hear them in the press. And then, after we go inside, we'd like you to identify your brother while the coroner's van is still here. It will save you from having to go down to the morgue. But we want you to be prepared first.
Prepared? Kate swallowed. All right. Detective Janek glanced around to check if anyone was close, then looked back to search Kate's eyes.
Whoever did this was pretty sick.
What do you mean?
He removed your brother's eyes.
Removed his eyes? Kate blinked. Why?
We haven't determined that. One of them was missing. The other was lying beside the body. It appears to have been partially eaten.
Kate's brain seemed to go blank. She usually had command of matters that needed figuring out. She usually knew just what to ask to get to the bottom of things. But now she couldn't seem to make her mind work. She felt numb with anger at someone hurting John and doing such a thing to him. She knew John's fears well. She tried not to imagine his cries of terror and pain. She felt a hot wave of guilt for not being there to protect him. Who could do such a thing?
That's what we're going to try to find out, Detective Sanders said.
Take me in there, Kate said, her anger rising. Show me what you need me to explain. Detectives Sanders and Janek shared a look at her determined tone, at the simmering rage it carried. When they started for the house, Kate followed close on Detective Sanders' heels. Detective Janek stayed protectively at her side. When they reached the steps, they put on blue paper booties and asked Kate to do the same. On the porch outside, a numbered yellow tag stood beside what looked like a bloody footprint. As she stepped into the living room, where there was more light, she saw a smear of blood at about eye level on the inside of the oak door. The blood in the living room didn't look the way Kate had imagined it. She thought it would be mostly soaked into the wood floor or dried up. Instead, not far inside the door, there was a horrific, vast pool of it that they had to skirt. Kate was shocked to see blood splattered everywhere in the living room. Besides what was on the floor, the violence of the attack had left strings and splatters of blood on the walls, the couch, the lampshades, even the drapes. Some dim, analytical part of her brain said, "So this is what a murder scene looks like." Kate saw smeared, bloody footprints in a twisting path. At the far edge of the pool of blood was a crooked smear that looked like it might have been where her brother's arm lay sprawled across the floor. There seemed little doubt that John had tried desperately to get away. He had not gone down easily. He had struggled for his life. "Why is that up here?" Kate asked, pointing. A rusty, four-tined garden fork lay on the floor near the pool of blood. A yellow plastic tag with the black number 6 stood beside it. She was beginning to see why they had questions. "My father used that fork to till a small garden in the backyard," she said. "In the fall, he dug potatoes with it." Kate frowned as she leaned down a little for a better look. "The tines have been sharpened. My father just turned dirt over with it. It was rusty and it wasn't sharp. The tips look like they've been filed." Before they could answer, Kate pointed to 4 splintered holes in the pine floor amid a broad area of blood. "It looks like someone stuck it in the floor right there." Detective Sanders nodded.
"I'm afraid that the killer used it to pin the deceased's feet to the floor, probably to prevent him from escaping."
Kate's jaw hung in stunned surprise. "Why not just hit him over the head?"
"We don't know the answer to that," Detective Janek said. "Sometimes it's simply an act of blind rage. Sometimes they have a reason. When I find him, I'll ask.
By the woman's icy, controlled expression, Kate knew that Detective Janek fully intended to keep that promise. Kate finally had to break her gaze with the woman to instead look around. By the way blood was splattered everywhere, she thought it looked like an act of blind rage.
"Do you know where the gardening fork was kept?"
Detective Sanders asked. Kate nodded. "In the basement." He turned to one of the forensic team and waggled his pen down at the floor as he spoke in a low voice.
"You can take it now."
The balding man wearing blue latex gloves squatted down and carefully fed the garden fork into a long cardboard box. Detective Janek gently took Kate's elbow, turning her away.
"What we'd really like to show you is in the basement."
The basement? Kate couldn't imagine what was in the basement, but she followed behind Detective Sanders as the man headed in that direction once Detective Janek gave him a nod. Unlike the living room, the short hall didn't have blood on the walls. Kate paused in the kitchen. Dirty forks and spoons stood up in a green plastic tumbler in the sink. John always washed the dishes after using them. I don't remember ever seeing him leave dirty dishes like that. Washing the dishes after he ate was part of his compulsive routine.
"Anything else that you notice out of the ordinary?" Detective Janek asked.
"My pictures," Kate said, gesturing. "John kept pictures of me on the refrigerator. All the corners were folded over. Sometimes he took the photos down and put them in his pocket for safekeeping. Otherwise, they were there, on the refrigerator." There were other pictures still there on the refrigerator, one of the bushes in the backyard in full bloom, an old one of their parents. But most of the rest were newspaper clippings. She looked back at the detectives. "Did John have my pictures with him?" Detective Sanders shook his head as he started writing a note in his pad.
"There weren't any pictures in his pockets."
Kate wondered where they were.
"Those magnets on the floor, then, were what he used to hold the photos of you on the refrigerator?"
Detective Janek asked. It sounded more like a statement than a question. Kate confirmed it with a nod. It felt so odd being in the house. She had grown up in the place and had always felt safe there. But now it felt alien. It felt violated. It felt dangerous. Kate followed the heavy-set Detective Sanders across the kitchen and down the plank steps into the musty basement. Detective Janek followed Kate down. Both of the bare bulb lights were on, casting harsh shadows. At the bottom, Kate was dumbfounded by what she saw.
"We suspect,"
Detective Sanders said, choosing his words carefully,
"that your brother had someone chained down here."
A heavy chain was padlocked to a large loop in the concrete floor. The iron ring had once been used as an anchor point to help straighten out a foundation wall. She had been little at the time, but she vaguely remembered men working in the basement, and she remembered a chain running through that heavy iron ring. Broken bits of metal lay at the end of the chain, snaked across the floor. To the side, against a foundation wall made of mortared brick, was a wastebasket, overflowing with used paper plates. Other plates lay randomly scattered around on the floor as if they had simply been flicked aside. Smears of dried food covered most of them.
"The chain would just reach the toilet and sink in that corner,"
Detective Sanders said, gesturing with his pen.
"But not this other side of the room."
The side of the room out of reach of the chain was stacked with years of dusty collected junk. There was everything from an old water heater that her father had meant to have hauled out, to boxes of outdoor Christmas decorations, to window screens, to broken chairs. In the corner stood a rake, a hoe, and a variety of shovels. The metal on all of them was rusty. "The garden fork used to be over there," Kate told them, pointing at the collection of tools standing in the corner. "Just as rusty as the rest of them." Detective Sanders glanced at the tools and nodded,
It appears that someone was chained down here for a few weeks.
Kate gestured to a screwdriver, pliers, and file on the floor. He must have used his clothes, maybe his belt, to finally snag some of the tools kept off on the other side of the room and then pull them closer. It looks like he used the tools to break the chain.
That's our assumption as well, Detective Sanders said.
Kate saw a pile of rusty iron filings. It looks like he used a file to sharpen the garden fork over there. Detective Sanders tilted his head around at the dirty paper plates ringing the room.
Have you ever known your brother to do anything like this before?
No, never, Kate said without hesitation as she gazed around at the scene. I can't explain any of this.
Has your brother ever acted violently? He asked.
Kate was shaking her head even as he was asking the question. No, she insisted. No, it wasn't in his nature. I mean, I know how this looks, but I simply can't imagine John doing such a thing. He was shy. If someone called him names, he ran away. He never got in fights. I never once knew him to fight back, even if someone shoved him. The most he would ever do was sit in his bedroom and brood. Detective Sanders glanced around again.
It appears that he moved beyond the brooding stage.
Kate lifted her arms in exasperation. And what? She let her hands flop down at her sides. A retarded man with the mind of a child overpowered a homicidal maniac who eats human eyeballs and kept him chained up down here? Detective Sanders arched an eyebrow.
So it would appear.
Chapter 5. Detective Janek rolled the steel-gray, unmarked police car to the curb, put it in park, and shut off the engine. There were still police at John's house and would be all night. She'd told Kate that the homicide detectives would be back there first thing in the morning to continue collecting evidence, interviewing all the neighbors, and following up on any leads. Detective Janek said she was going home to get a few hours' sleep and had offered to drop Kate off at her house. Kate knew better. She knew it was not simply a convenient lift home. She knew that it was an opportunity for the homicide detective to have Kate isolated so she could question her informally without making it sound like an interrogation. In her own job, Kate often made some people nervous. When she showed up, it was only because there was trouble, and she was there to get to the bottom of it. The innocent, hard-working people were often more nervous about her questions than the ones causing the problems, so in those cases she tried to frame her questions in a gentle, non-threatening way. Kate, though, had no real answers for the detective's gentle questioning, but did her best to be open and honest. She wanted her brother's killer found and brought to justice. Despite the wide-ranging questions sprinkled in among the small talk, Kate could tell that the woman had something else on her mind. Kate did too. She was confused and upset by what she had seen in the basement, but those thoughts were blanketed by the weight of grief. Between her job and spending a great deal of her free time with John, she never really had the chance to develop close friendships, so in an odd way, John had not only been her responsibility, but her closest friend. Now, she felt all alone in the world. John had always depended on her. She should have known something was wrong. She should have been there. When she had been little, her mother had often talked to her in a serious tone, telling her that John would always have to depend on them to watch over him, because he couldn't do it himself. She'd said that was just the way it was. Kate had always known that there was an implied, sometimes life isn't fair and that's just the way it is, at the end of her mother's words. After her parents had died, that left only Kate to watch over her brother. John had always been a sympathetic ear, never interrupting as she sometimes rambled on about her own problems at work. His problems were usually simple for her to fix. She couldn't help wondering, though, if she had made the wrong choices in the larger life decisions for her brother and if those decisions had resulted in him dying alone and afraid. Mostly, though, she knew she should have been there for him. "This is my fault," Kate said, as she stared at the meaningless numbers, addresses, and names on the police computer screen mounted between the front seats. "It's normal for people to feel guilty, to feel there was something they could have done. But this isn't your fault, Kate." Kate stared at the computer screen without seeing it. "Yes, it is. I could have prevented this." The detective paused a moment before asking, "What are you talking about?" Kate finally looked over at the other woman. "My plane came in this afternoon. I was booked to fly back tomorrow night, but my investigation had finished up, and by luck I was able to get on a flight back today. I could have picked John up from work, or I could have gone to his house and been there for him when he got home. If I had gone to his house first..." Detective Jenek's brow tightened.
"With the way you looked after him? And after having been gone for 3 weeks? Why didn't you?"
Kate swallowed. "A woman I know from work is in the hospital. I heard about it when I was out of town. When I got in, the driver from my office who picked me up at the airport let me know that she isn't likely to live the night. John hadn't been expecting me to be back until tomorrow night, so I had the driver take me home to drop off my bags and change before I had him take me to the hospital. I wanted to stop and see her. I wanted to be there to support her family. She has a nice family."
"Oh. I'm awfully sorry to hear that. What's wrong with her?"
Kate's gaze wandered back to the computer screen. "The side of her face is caved in. Her eye socket is crushed. Even if she lives, they say she will be blind in that eye. She has brain damage from bone fragments. Her husband told me that she already had 2 operations to save her life, but there is only so much the doctors can do. He said that even if she lives, she will never be Wilma again."
"Wilma?"
Detective Jenick's gaze flicked to the computer screen.
"How did it happen?"
"A few days ago, she went out to lunch and a guy walking past her, right outside our building, suddenly hit her in the face as hard as he could. He was big and powerful. She was small and frail. She went down and hasn't recovered consciousness since. Her children were there at the hospital. The doctors told them all that she isn't likely to make it through the night. People at work said that a blurry video of it was posted online. The guys in the video were laughing at the way she went down and giving high fives to the guy who did it." The detective nodded.
"Now I know who you're talking about. I saw the report. It was another case of the knockout game."
Kate shook her head without looking up. "Some game. She might die."
"She wouldn't be the first nor the last. The videos spread like a disease. We've had a raft of such attacks, as have a number of other cities. It's murder in my book, or at least attempted murder, but they rarely get caught. Since it's random, they don't have any connection to their victims. Since it's usually not possible to identify the attackers from the videos, there's not much evidence to go on. Even when they do get caught, their punishment rarely matches the severity of the harm they do."
"It's hard to believe what the world is coming to."
"I couldn't agree more," Detective Jenick said with a sigh. "The law is increasingly viewed with contempt, and the police are seen as oppressors for enforcing it."
She seemed to catch herself and looked back over at Kate.
"So you stopped in to see her rather than go to see John first?"
"Yes." Kate looked over into the woman's dark eyes. "The driver was taking me home after I spent some time at the hospital. I was tired from a long day. John hadn't expected me to get in until tomorrow, so I was planning on going to bed early and getting a good night's sleep and then seeing John tomorrow. I called him from the car when I was almost home. When I heard him scream for me to run, I immediately called 911 from the car while the driver rushed me to John's house. You all beat me there. If I'd done as I'd originally planned and surprised John by picking him up from his job rather than go to the hospital, then he wouldn't be dead. But I didn't want to take him with me to the hospital. He doesn't like to see people who are hurting.
You only did what made the most sense.
Kate swallowed at the lump swelling in the back of her throat. No. I should have taken care of my brother first. If I had gone to his house, I would have found out that something was going on, that there was someone chained in the basement. I would have found out and called the police. Kate turned away to stare out the window into the darkness. Wilma was unconscious and didn't even know I was there. I hadn't seen John in 3 weeks. I should have seen to him first, and then this would never have happened. John would have told me if I'd gone to the house. It's my fault he's dead.
You're wrong, Kate.
Detective Janek leaned in a little closer.
Listen to me. Someone murdered him. That's who is at fault, not you. The only thing that would be different had you gone there first is that you would have walked into a very bizarre scene, an unexpected scene. You would have been caught unaware and murdered along with your brother. Whatever was happening, his death is not your fault. You need to know that.
Kate offered a brief smile. I wish I could believe that.
Someday you will. In the meantime, I'm going to work very hard to find the guy who did this. We have a lot of people to interview. We'll find a lead that takes us to the killer.
Do you get the names of all the people who were standing around watching?
You bet we do.
Kate stared out the window at nothing. There was a tall man with messy hair in the crowd. He had his hands in the pockets of a loose-fitting dark jacket. I think it was a hoodie. You should talk to him.
Why do you say that? Do you know something about him? Do you know who he is? Has he ever caused trouble for John?
Kate blinked and looked over at the frowning detective. What? No. No, I don't know him. I've never seen him before. She shook her head. I don't even know why I mentioned it.
Maybe because you know the people in the neighborhood and you didn't recognize him as belonging there?
Kate suddenly felt foolish and wished she hadn't said something so out of the blue. In fact, she was puzzled as to why she had. Maybe that's it. I grew up there and I know most of the people in the neighborhood. I recognized a number of the faces, even if I don't know their names. But the man just seemed... I don't know. I don't know why I said anything.
What did he look like?
Kate tried to remember any details. I never saw his face. I only saw him from the back. He was 6'1", 6'2", something like that. I couldn't see him very well. He was back where it was dark, so I don't even know what color his hair was. I could just see by the way he was silhouetted in the lights from police cars that his hair was sticking up and messy. Detective Janek was still frowning, still staring at her.
You didn't see his face at all? Did you make eye contact?
Kate shook her head again. No. I guess I'm just so shaken that I'm grasping at straws.
Did John have a hoodie?
Yes, dark blue. He kept it in the closet to the side of the front door. The detective pulled out her phone and pressed a couple of keys with her thumb.
It's me, she said after a moment when someone answered. You still at the house? Good. Do me a favor. Go inside and check in the closet by the front door. Tell me if there's a dark blue hoodie in there.
While she was waiting, Kate asked, You think the guy took John's hoodie? Maybe to cover up the blood? Before she could answer, the detective still at the house came back on the line, and Detective Janek pressed the phone back to her ear.
Okay, thanks, she said. See you in the morning.
She slipped the phone back in her pocket.
John's hoodie is still there.
Oh. Okay, sorry.
I shouldn't be trying to give you leads when I don't know what I'm even talking about.
It's part of the job. Most leads end up going nowhere, but sometimes they do.
She frowned again.
Are you usually a suspicious person?
It's my job.
I thought you were an accountant. You said you were an auditor for Cadex.
Not that kind of an auditor, Kate said. I'm a security auditor. I get paid to be suspicious.
Really?
The detective was staring again.
Are you good at it?
Feeling self-conscious, Kate shrugged. I'm told I have a knack for it. I must be good enough. I still have a job.
Who are you paid to be suspicious of?
Cadex Systems supplies parts for missile guidance systems. It's a pretty sensitive industry, so we're naturally serious about everything we do. We have an electronic security team. That's a whole world unto itself. I don't generally get called in on that kind of issue unless it's an internal breach. But there are other threats. Thieves trying to steal valuable equipment, corporate spies after sensitive information, people with a grudge against the company who want to cause trouble, that kind of thing. When a bad actor like that slips into the company under the radar, they become my responsibility. I deal with that kind. It's my job to ferret them out.
Sort of a corporate cop?
Kate offered a weak smile. I'm hardly in your league. It's nothing like what you do. The woman was back to studying Kate's eyes, but she didn't say anything. Well, it's pretty late, Kate said as she curled her fingers around the door handle. Thank you for the ride home.
Kate.
Kate paused before opening the door. Detective Jenick tapped the palm of her hand on the steering wheel. What is it? Kate couldn't imagine what questions could be left. She'd answered so many already that the detective probably now knew more about her than anyone alive. The woman stared down at her hand, gripping the wheel. Her jaw muscles flexed as she considered.
I know this isn't a good time, but would it be all right if I came in and we had a private conversation?
A private conversation?
Yes. A private conversation that's strictly off the record.
Kate cocked her head. Off the record? What do you mean?
I mean, just between you and me. Not to be repeated. Not to anyone.
She finally looked over and held up her thumb, pointing her first finger as if it were a gun.
If you repeat a word of it, I'll have to shoot you.
The woman dropped her thumb, imitating dropping the hammer of a gun. Kate frowned, not knowing what to say. The detective smiled then in a suddenly human way, breaking the tension. And in the sincerity of that smile, Kate saw the woman beneath the cool veneer of authority.
Just kidding. About shooting you, I mean. But it is strictly confidential, and I'm asking you to keep it that way.
It's kind of late, Detective, Kate said as she glanced past the barren trees toward her house. The trees would leaf out soon. It was a beautiful street when the maples all leafed out. The older neighborhood had deep yards and mature landscaping that afforded privacy. I haven't even unpacked yet.
I wouldn't ask if it weren't important, Detective Jenick said.
She sounded troubled.
Kate stared into the woman's dark eyes a moment.
They were intense with resolve, along with something Kate couldn't quite figure out. Worry, maybe. Or maybe fear. Sure. Okay. Kate hooked some of her black hair behind an ear. I'll make some coffee. Detective Jenick smiled with relief.
AJ. Everyone calls me AJ.
She let out a weary sigh.
And coffee would be great.
Chapter 6. Kate unlocked the heavy oak door and let them both in.
Her house wasn't large, but it had been built with the kind of care and attention to detail that didn't grace newer homes. The crown moldings were finely detailed and perfectly fitted. The walls were real plaster, the cabinets real wood. It wasn't grand or at all extravagant, but it had the kind of simple honesty that had become all too rare. Without being showy, the place exuded a warmth and charm that Kate had always cherished. It was a comforting retreat from the rest of her life. On the way to the kitchen, she noticed that the message machine on a side table beside the couch was blinking. Everyone who knew her called her on her cell. The only people who ever called on her home phone anymore were salespeople and fundraisers. That kind of annoying message was about the last thing in the world she wanted to hear right then. In the small kitchen, Kate flicked on the light switch. While AJ followed her in, looking about, Kate pulled a stainless steel canister out from under the cabinets against the wall. After she set the coffee pot's filter basket on the white laminate counter and put in a paper filter, she added 4 scoops of coffee. As she filled the pot with water at the kitchen sink, she watched out of the corner of her eye as the detective studied the family photos on the wall.
"Looks like you get your lustrous black hair from your mother."
Kate saw that she was looking at a 25-year-old photo of her parents, standing on the front porch, with Kate and John sitting on the steps at their feet.
"And you have your father's green eyes. It's a rather striking combination."
"We're all products of heredity," Kate said.
"It's not like we get to choose."
The woman looked back over her shoulder, momentarily giving Kate an odd, unreadable look. She turned back to the photos on the wall and pointed at one.
"What's this one?"
"It's when I earned my black belt." The detective made an appreciative expression.
"Do you still practice?"
"Healthy body, healthy mind," Kate said. "I find that working out helps relieve stress. Sweating from beating the hell out of a bag is a good way to get rid of frustration."
"So you work out at a gym?"
"Twice a week at a combat concepts with an instructor." When AJ raised an eyebrow, Kate explained, "My job is to find out who is causing problems. Sometimes it's simply incompetence, but most of the time it's criminal activity of one sort or another. We have security people, and I've never had any problems, but you never know. I feel better being prepared. The rest of the time I work out at home. I have some simple equipment in the basement. A spinner bike for high-intensity work, weights, jump rope, that kind of thing." AJ looked back at the photo.
"I prefer working out at home, too. My husband is a gym rat, but I don't like strange men leering at me from behind when I'm doing deadlifts."
Kate tilted her head toward the nook. "You've been on your feet a long time. Why don't you have a seat?" The expanse of windows created out of smaller squares of glass in a grid of painted wood mullions looked out over a deep backyard. It made the nook in the kitchen a cheerful, cozy place to have coffee in the morning. With the shrubs and trees all along the property line blocking out other homes, it was like gazing out on her own private sanctuary. Now, the black abyss out the windows offered no sanctuary, but instead echoed her mood. AJ set her small business satchel down and then slid it ahead of her into the booth on the far side of the table so she would be facing Kate.
"You aren't crying," the detective observed.
Kate took a deep breath as she pulled a pair of white cups from the upper cabinet. "I probably will, later, when I'm alone. Maybe it just hasn't all quite sunk in yet. It doesn't seem real. I mean, if John had been hit by a car, I think it would seem real, but this..."
"I understand," AJ said.
"After the things I saw in John's house, maybe it doesn't make enough sense to me to seem real." Kate set the cups on the counter, staring into them for a moment. "Maybe I'm afraid that if I cry, it will become real." From a young age, she had learned to set her own emotions aside when it came to John. He was like a child who needed her help to survive. That was just the way it was. Her responsibilities weren't so bad, and they had their rewards. She had a good life. Maybe being somewhat detached and analytical had become her way of dealing with everything in her life, from John to her job. AJ nodded as she rested her forearms on the table and interlaced her fingers.
Do you have anyone? It's often easier to handle these kinds of losses if you aren't alone.
My parents are gone.
Anyone else? Someone close to you? A special man you care about?
No. Kate shrugged one shoulder, uncomfortable with an unexpectedly alien notion at such a time. I guess I haven't found the right one yet. I don't know why, but men have always seemed to be intimidated by me.
Maybe they've seen you taking out your aggression on a punching bag, AJ said.
Kate smiled. Maybe that's it. She looked up. Cream or sugar for your coffee? Detective Jenek was watching her hands again.
Cream, please.
Kate retrieved a small carton of heavy cream from the refrigerator. She smelled it first to make sure it was still good, and then poured some into a small pitcher. John was used to the house because he grew up there, she said into the dragging silence, feeling the need to explain. After my parents passed away, it just made sense for him to continue living there. I'd already moved out before my parents both passed away, not a year apart. She stared at the pitcher for a moment, searching for the words. I just didn't want to go back. I know it probably sounds cruel that I didn't go back there to live with John and watch over him, but he was doing fine on his own, and I was on my own, and I just didn't... I understand, AJ said in a sympathetic tone. John needed to be on his own. You both did. Kate forced a brief smile, along with a nod. The woman lightened the mood with a change of subject, talking a bit about her husband, Mike, and her little boy, Ryan. Despite how much both AJ's husband and son obviously meant to her, Kate could tell that the woman was killing time, working up to the confidential conversation she'd wanted to have. Kate asked some simple questions about AJ's son, not really hearing the answers. In her mind's eye, she kept seeing her brother's blood on the floor and the chain down in the basement, with the dirty paper plates thrown off to the sides. For the life of her, she couldn't come up with an explanation that made any sense. Kate didn't like it when things didn't make sense. She could deal with problems, but the reasons behind them had to make sense. When the coffee was ready, Kate poured two cups and set them on the table, along with spoons, paper napkins, and the pitcher of cream, then slid into the booth opposite the detective. As Detective Jenek poured the cream, Kate asked, "So, what does the A in AJ stand for?" As she looked up from under her brow, a crooked smile twisted the detective's expression.
"If I wanted people to know my first name, I wouldn't tell them to call me AJ now, would I?"
By the way she smiled, Kate knew the woman had been asked that question countless times before, and because her answer was so quick in coming, Kate knew that for some reason it was not a question the woman enjoyed getting. Point taken. Kate poured herself a healthy dose of cream when the other woman handed her the pitcher. "So, what's the big secret you want to talk about?" AJ wrapped her fingers around the cup and stared into her coffee for a time, watching in silence as the cream swirled around. "I knew your brother," she finally said in a quiet voice. Kate's hand with the pitcher froze in midair just before she set it on the table. Goosebumps tingled up her arms. She finally set the pitcher down. "You knew John?" AJ nodded, still staring into her coffee. "I propped a card up on his phone on the wall in the hallway. It was my personal card. I told him that he could call me any time, day or night. My cell is always on." Chapter 7. Kate was bewildered as to why John had never told her about Detective Jenek. John told Kate everything. She suddenly realized how wrong she had been about that. She knew that her being out of town isolated him somewhat, but there were people at work who could help him if need be, and they had Kate's number. Even though she hadn't seen him in weeks, she called often. She couldn't imagine her brother not telling her about Detective Janek. But even more, she was completely at a loss that he hadn't given her any hint about having a man chained in the basement. At least, not until the last moments of his life, when he'd told her to run. "I looked at the phone in John's house," Kate said. "I didn't see any card there."
"I looked too," AJ said. "It was gone. Maybe John put it away somewhere."
"How did you know John, and why would you give him your card?" AJ lifted a hand in a weak gesture.
"I wanted him to have it in case he ever needed me."
"Needed you?" Kate leaned in. "Why didn't you say anything at the house? Why didn't you mention this when we were talking with the other detectives?" AJ let out a deep sigh and finally looked up.
"It will take a bit of explaining."
The look of iron returned to her eyes. It was a look that Kate did not take lightly.
"Like I told you, this is strictly confidential. I'm not kidding, Kate. This has to stay between you and me."
Kate didn't know that she wanted to be bound by such terms without knowing the details, especially since it involved the death of her brother. But she decided not to voice her objections for the moment. "I'm listening." AJ turned a little to the side and leafed through the satchel resting on the bench beside her. She finally pulled out a thick brown envelope.
"I'd like you to look at some pictures."
Kate thought it an awfully strange change of subject, but she decided to see where the woman was going.
"All right."
Detective Janek pulled out a deck of photos, drawing the rubber band off the stack and back onto her wrist. She picked a single picture off the top.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.